I'm a software developer intern at HackerRank, and I'm doing my GSOC with Homebrew, and I'm working on increasing test coverage for Brew, and I did my Outreachy with Mozilla. Now, for those of you who do not know about Outreachy, Outreachy is basically an initiative of the Software Freedom Conservancy. It's open to participation for women, transgenders, and other underrepresented communities. There are two rounds every year for Outreachy. I participate in the last round, which was held from December to March. And for more information, you can find it on genome.org/outreachy. Now, I did my Outreachy with Mozilla, and the project that I worked on was Kinto. So Kinto is basically a minimalist JSON storage service. It has synchronization and sharing abilities. It's basically written in Python, and in Firefox, it's used for remote settings and storage.sync API. Now, a little more about how Kinto is used in Firefox. Now, there are two client libraries that are embedded in Firefox. One is the Kinto HTTP client, which sends across HTTP requests to the Kinto API to fetch data, while the Kinto offline client is used for offline synchronization. Now, the applications where this actually is used is OneCRL, which is basically a list of the revoked certificates. Then it also has a list of add-ons and plugins that are malicious, and it protects you from using those. And then it's also used in the storage.sync API, and it also stores data for A/B testing experiments in iOS. Now, coming to the main topic of today that we're discussing, which is WebPush. Now, first, I'd like to explain the entire terminology of WebPush, how it all works, what all elements are at play here. There are three things. One is a service worker. A service worker is basically a JavaScript file which works in the background. It handles notifications and also background sync APIs. Now, a service worker can only work on a website or web page that is registered over HTTPS. Coming to the push server, a push server is basically a server that is associated with the browser. It acts as a router between the browser and the web application server. It helps route data from the web application server to the browser. Now, the web app server. The web app server is basically the server associated with your web application, which sends out information to the user agent, basically the users. Now, the entire structure of how it works. So basically, when you load a website which has the facility of sending you notifications, you see a pop-up which asks you if you'd like to subscribe for notifications. If you click on Allow, the service worker associated with the web app sends a request to the push server of the browser saying, hey, I would like to subscribe to notifications, and please give me some credentials so that I can forward it to the web application server and inform the web application server where to reach out to me. So the push server responds back with two things. One is the encryption keys. Second is the capability URL. Now, there are two ways in which information can be accessed over the internet. First is through a password or a token, wherein the user who has to access the information has the password or the token. And the other way is that the information is available on obscure URLs, and people who should have access to that information are the only ones with access to those URLs. Such URLs are called capability URLs. So the push server responds back with a capability URL and an encryption key. Once the service worker receives these, it needs to send it to the web application server saying, hey, this is where you can reach out to me. And the server, the web application server, which I'm calling as the Kinto server here right now in the use case, stores the endpoint and the encryption keys. Now, when the server has to push information out to the users, it takes the payload, which is basically the information that has to be sent across, and uses these encryption keys to encrypt the payload, and then sends across a request to the push server of the browser, sends a post request basically to the push server saying, hey, please send this information across. And then the push server can send it across to the browser, can send it across to the browser using a UAID. Now, a UAID is basically the user agent ID with which a push server recognizes a particular browser. So it sends it across to your browser using the UAID, and then the browser routes it across to the particular service worker using a channel ID. Now, if the user is not online at that time, then the push server will queue up the message that had to be sent for a particular amount of time, called the TTL, which is the time to live header, which has to be pre-specified by the web application server. Now, coming to the part where the project I'm talking about, the microservice that I and my mentor designed to use as the web push microservice. Now, considering the use case, we decided that a PubSub paradigm would be best for designing it. Now, PubSub is basically publish subscribe, in which there are publishers and subscribers. The subscribers choose to subscribe to certain channels according to the information they want to be notified about. And the publishers send across information to a particular channel. It's sent across in one push. And the users that have subscribed to a particular channel get the information about it. Now, since we need to maintain information about channels, and then we also need to save subscriptions, the data about the encryption keys and the capability URLs, we needed two endpoints specifically, which would be the slash channels and the slash subscriptions endpoints. And now we also do not want to have user management, basically not having a username or password for using this. So we decided for authentication, we'd need OAuth 2 bearer tokens. Now the major question that we had at hand was, how to go about designing it? What language to use, what framework to use, how to go about it? So then we used Kinto.core. Kinto.core is not like a framework. It's basically like a toolkit which you can use to create HTTP REST APIs. It exposes well-defined endpoints, and it's built using Cornice, Pyramid, and SQL Alchemy Core. SQL Alchemy Core for database sessions and pooling, and Cornice and Pyramid for all the HTTP stuff and the REST stuff. Now with Kinto.core, you get the independence to customize, and also you get a lot of default endpoints. So the only task we had at hand was to add the endpoints we required, which was channels and subscriptions. That was basically customizing it for our use case. The other endpoints were already there, for example, the heartbeat endpoint and other endpoints. And it also had the ability to handle the authentication for us, handle monitoring for us, and also gave us the ability to add cache if we needed. Now, coming to the channels endpoint. The channels endpoint is such that if you want to register a new channel, even if the channel does not exist already, you can register it using the put slash channel slash channel ID slash registration, and you can add any new channel ID here. And to delete a particular channel, you can use delete slash channel slash channel ID slash registration. And to get information about a particular channel, say you want to know how many users have registered to a particular channel and how many times information has been pushed out to that channel, you can get that information using get slash channels slash channel ID. And to post information to a particular channel, you can use post slash channel slash channel ID. Now, coming to the endpoint subscriptions, where we need to maintain information about what encryption keys and endpoint URLs have come from a particular user. Post slash subscriptions will let you send information, will let you post the subscription information to the microservice, to the API basically. Get slash subscriptions will help you fetch information about subscriptions of a particular user. Delete will help you delete all the subscriptions. And if you want to delete a particular subscription ID, delete slash subscription ID will do that. Now, coming to the demo part, I'll start the server. It starts using makeserve. So it's running on the 9999 port. And now to subscribe to a channel, I'm sending a put request to subscribe to the channel. And here, as you can see, the server's running at localhost 9999, as I started it earlier. And the version is v0. And the channel ID that I'm using is form builder update. It's just a random string that I'm using. And the registration endpoint for registering. And the auth token that I'm using for authentication. So I have subscribed to that channel. Now to push information to that channel, I can send the JSON that I have, which is data last modified and some information to the, I am posting this to the endpoint /channel/channel ID using the authentication token. And I've been able to post it, and I get 202 since it has been accepted. Now, I'd like to thank my mentor, Remy, for helping me and guiding me all through this project. And this was my outreach project, basically. Now, for those of you who would like to start contributing to Kinto, you can find us on GitHub at github.com/kinto. And you can also join our Slack channel on slack.kintostorage.org. And you can also join our IRC channel on irc.freenode.net. And I'm an intern at HackerRank. And for those companies who still use the normal phone screening way and use Skype for interviewing, HackerRank for Work gives you the ability to conduct interviews online. It's an online assessment platform. And also, it really helps fasten the recruiting process. It helps your recruiters and hiring managers filter out qualified candidates pretty quickly. And HackerRank also has HackerRank for Community, which is basically where developers can practice their coding skills. Thank you. You can contact me on Gmail, and you can follow me on GitHub and Twitter, and you can contact me on LinkedIn. And that's it. Thank you. My talk got selected pretty late, so I did not have a lot of time to prepare. So I could prepare only a really short talk. Thank you. Any questions?
We have plenty of time for questions. Yes, we have one question there.
Hi, thanks for your talk. Would I be able, if I wanted, could I use Kinto and other parts of Mozilla?
I'm not able to understand what you're saying.
If I wanted to use Kinto, could I set up my own push server using Kinto and, you know, branch Firefox and point it at my own push server?
Yeah, you can definitely use this. It's basically called the microservice that is there is called WebPush Channels, and you can definitely use it to integrate it with your web application, and you can use it for push notifications. You'll basically have to add a service worker file, which will be in JavaScript, and you'll have to send a request to the push server. Basically, there's an endpoint. I don't remember the exact URL. It's the Mozilla push, basically the browser's push server. You have to send a request. There's already a function in JavaScript also if you don't want to explicitly send a request. So once you send the request, you will get back the credentials. Send the credentials to the using a post request to this server. There's a running instance of this server on, I don't remember the URL again, but there's a running instance of this server. And you can send a request, a post request. The subscriptions will be saved, and then you can register to whatever channels you want using the using a put request. And then whenever a notification has to be sent out, that you can trigger by sending a request to the server again. And the server will then route it to the push server, and then it will be shown to the users using a notification. And in fact, you can also use Kinto.core for other projects. It's Kinto.core is basically made of, like, made out of, like, it's made using Pyramid, Cornice, and SQL Alchemy. So Kinto.core can be used for a variety of other projects as well.
Excellent. Any other question? Any other question? Well, I have a question. So can you give us an idea of the type of, you know, performance or, you know, maybe hardware requirement to handle? You know, I imagine this type of system gets a lot of load, a lot of messages going out to browsers all around. Is it very heavy, a very heavy process? Do you need big servers or is it something that is fairly lightweight and, you know, just a regular?
So I'm not aware what server instance is being used for this, but my mentor Remy, he works at Mozilla, so he set up this server. So whatever Mozilla uses for their servers, so that is being used for this for this server, the WebPush channel server, and so basically, Kinto.core handles all the Kinto.core is able to handle all the requests that come across in a fast manner, and like this is why we chose to use Kinto.core, because there was very little work on our part. Kinto.core has already has the ability to handle all the post requests in a really fast manner, so we just had to create a few functions which could handle that particular endpoint, and there were already many custom endpoints that were there with Kinto.core. So yeah, that's about it.
Okay, thanks. Any other question? If I don't see you folks, just wave. But okay, if there are no more questions, then let's thank our speaker again.